The celebrated Italian opera composer Giacomo Puccini was not only famous for his accurate portrayals of his leading ladies, but also, paradoxically enough, he was infamous for being a womanizer and, listen to this, an animal hunter. As a matter of fact, during his stay here in Buenos Aires, he was caught at the Paraná River hunting down geese and ducks with his ever-present cigar on one hand and a rifle. Other illustrious guests include the German composer Richard Strauss. He actually never conducted outside of Europe, except for, you guessed it, Buenos Aires. Here, he led the local premiere of his opera Electra, as well as his, at the time, quite controversial Salome. He also conducted several concerts with the Vienna Philharmonic. It was under the composer's baton that the Porteños first got acquainted with his tone poems, such as Thus Spoke Zarathustra, the Alpine Symphony, and his bombastic autobiographies, The Domestic Symphony, and that not quite humble self-portrait that bears the title A Hero's Life. Speaking of which, I mean of larger-than-life autobiographies and blasting self-portraits, Strauss's most self-referent opera is Intermezzo. In a sense, it is probably his most German opera, or rather, I should say, the most Bavarian of them all. In fact, the main characters are a grumpy scat-playing composer and his nagging wife. It can't get any more autobiographical than that. Anyways, it came to me as a surprise to learn that an extensive chunk of that piece was written here, close to the River Plate, rather than the Isar. Of course, Strauss was not the only celebrity composer to visit us back then. Mascagni, for instance, actually had one of his operas premiered in Buenos Aires. I'm talking about Isabeau, which was written for the Coliseum Theater just a few blocks away from the Colón. Strauss visited Buenos Aires, but he never reached, for instance, New York, let alone during the war, as he was accused of playing along with the Nazi regime. But several other famous European composers did in fact visit the Big Apple and other cities of the up-and-coming America of that time. Take, for instance, Antonín Dvořák, a train aficionado who was absolutely dazzled with the American locomotives and the railway technical developments. Tchaikovsky, on the other hand, felt so depressed that he rarely left his hotel room. And what about Gustav Mahler? He's said to have taken the A train, that is, the subway, aka public transportation, to commute to his job as main conductor of the New York Philharmonic Orchestra. On the other hand, a composer as famous as Verdi never visited the Americas, not North America nor South America. He did travel extensively though, getting as far as the Tsarist Russia and crossing the channel to the Victorian England. And of course, he paid visits to the main operatic centers of his time in France, Germany and Austria. I read somewhere that when he had to travel across the frozen steppes all the way to St. Petersburg, he had a special rail wagon attached to the train. It contained a large collection of the very best French wines for he and his wife to savor. He seemingly was less of a patriot when it came to wines. Be it what it may, he never got to our continent. Or did he? It may be said that he did, only that in his creations. As a matter of fact, some of his operas are somehow related to the American continent. The Austrian censorship banned his opera, Un ballo in maschera, for portraying a regicide on stage. The assassination of King Gustav III of Sweden. Verdi complied and degraded his main character from a king to some fictitious governor, and the action was transferred from the court of Stockholm to the 17th century Boston, Massachusetts. That's America, right? What about La Forza del Destino, the Force of Destiny? Its ill-fortuned main character, the tenor, was a Peruvian guy. In fact, he was the offspring of a ñusta, that is, an Inca princess and a Spanish conquistador. Among those, let's call them his American operas, there's a much lesser known work. Moreover, it was not even a success in Verdi's lifetime. Its premiere in Naples in 1845 had a run of only 4 performances. We're talking about Alzira, one of the maestro's early operas. The plot is entirely set in Peru. The storyline is as improbable as that of many operas of the bel canto era. There's this Inca guy, Zamoro. Not Tupac Amaru or Huayna Capac, but Zamoro. Zamoro. In an attempt to defeat the Spaniards, Zamoro has led several attacks against the Spanish stronghold in Lima. He is finally imprisoned, but somehow manages to escape. Anyways, in these operas, the rivals are always a tenor and a baritone who end up in love with the same soprano. In this case, the tenor's adversary is a Spanish nobleman by the name of Guzmano. Our leading lady, Alzira, in an attempt to clear the waters and to stop the bloodshed, agrees to marry Guzmano, the Spanish foe, in spite of her love for Zamoro, the slightly overweight, handsome tenor dressed in an Inca costume. After a brief mulling over the events expressed in a beautiful aria, our tenor is finally determined to break the wedding and rushes out, but not before belting out a bright bravura cabaletta. In other words, the opera is indeed as conventional as it gets, but it is perked up by the irresistible vigor and the forcefulness of Maestro Giuseppe's early works. Nowadays, it's rarely performed. It has had a few revivals over the last century, though. Perhaps one of the most newsworthy took place some 20 years ago in Lima, the city where the stodgy action takes place. I'm sharing the link to my own rendition of Zamoro's aria from Verdi's Alzira down here in the description box. If you like it, and if you like this video, give him a thumbs up. If you like it a lot, consider subscribing to my channel. Additionally, you can become my patron for as little as $1 a month by visiting patreon.com/lauraborjasalazar.